What is up, everyone? Welcome to the wild card round edition of the Fantasy Points matchup live stream here. I'm John Hansen, Greg Cosell, Adam Caplan standing by with our guy Ben Kukanis on the other side of the glass. Six games to get to here. And Greg Cosell, of course, the senior producer and analyst on the matchup show on ESPN, has been all through it. Mr. Caplan, of course, doing his thing as well. So we'll kick it off here, guys. The analysis starts with the Vegas Raiders and the Cincinnati Bengals. And starting with the Bengals, Greg, I know you've been observing Joe Burrow big time. And, you know, the head coach, the play caller here, Taylor, has been a lot more aggressive. They're throwing a lot more on early downs. You know, Joe Mixon in this first matchup got 30 carries. Do you think they continue that trend of being more aggressive in this matchup against a pretty good secondary?
Yeah, you know, it's funny you say that. Because I went back this week and looked at the week 11 game, because that was not that long ago, week 11. You know, it wasn't as if it was week two or three. And that was a very odd game for the Bengals offense. Joe Burrow's longest pass completion in that game was 17 yards. Mm-hmm. And he did take a couple of shots to Chase, but Brandon Faison did a really good job. He played Chase really well, because one thing, John and Adam, that the Raiders do is with their corners, they play boundary and field. So Faison will be the boundary corner and Haywood will be the field corner. So they don't travel. They play boundary and field. But Chase is predominantly the boundary X receiver, right, for the Bengals. But it was a very odd game. Burrow had 20 completions for less than 150 yards. That's almost hard to do. So obviously everybody has been speaking about Burrow based on the last 3-4 weeks, and deservedly so. And I'd be very surprised, guys, if this game played out exactly the same. But, you know, that pass rush of the Raiders versus that O-line, that is not a good one-on-one pass protecting O-line. And that will be a factor in this game.
Argue, I guess, Greg, to your point there, that the Raiders are pretty well equipped to slow these guys down, because they've got three pretty good corners. You're talking Faison out there, likely on Chase more than half the time.
Yeah.
Casey Hayward and Nate Hobbs covering, you know, when they're man to man, Tyler Boyd in the slot here. So maybe it is a Joe Mixon game again.
I guess we'll see, because, you know, that game, if people just pull up the box score and look, it was 30-13, but it was 16-13 until there were 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter when Burrow hit Chase for a touchdown. So that was a very close game and kind of a physical game. It was really kind of a fun game to go back through again, because obviously it was week 11. So I looked at all my notes, but I still wanted to go back and look at some plays.
Yeah. And Adam, it's amazing. The playoffs are upon us. And all of a sudden I look at the practice report. Everyone's a full participant.
Yeah. they're all go. Oh, you know, I should mention with Brandon Faison, what's interesting is, like, the Chargers really did not feel that when Staley took over that he'd be a good fit for their scheme. So what happened is Gus Bradley, who's now coaching.
Right.
It's just funny how that happened, because the Chargers didn't want him. He was on the practice squad. Think about it. He's now starting off of another team's practice squad, but he's brought in for scheme. So as Greg said, you know, they play that cover three. You've been saying it all season. Do they ever play anything but cover three?
No. It's funny. They've played a lot more cover one as the season has gone on. I mean, relatively speaking to their scheme, they don't play cover one, you know, among the highest percentages in the league. They're still a lower percentage relative to other teams, but they've played more man. They're high percentage single high. That's what we should say. So they play with a single high post safety and either play cover three or cover one. Once in a while, depending on situations, I'm sure they could play split safety. And then there's always, they don't blitz much, but when they do, there's always blitz coverages, which are different than just your normal coverages.
Did Burrow take any, you mentioned he took deep
shots in Chase, one in the end zone, and then just one, you know, in the field. And Faison on both occasions played him really well.
Wow.
Amazing.
I mean, if they're single high, I mean, they'd probably do that again, right?
Of course they will. Yeah. I think they're going to, I could be totally wrong. And again, I'm not a good prognosticator. I think the Bengals will try to be aggressive early and see how it. I don't think the Bengals are going to come out and try to play close to the vest.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense.
They're going to come out and try to be aggressive and see how it goes.
Because Faison is a guy that you would think, now, I give him credit, and you just pointed out how well he played that game, and he's been a great story. It's kind of amazing. Yeah. He's in there because of the scheme and from, you know, because of Bradley's relationship with him. But that would be a guy, I would think, of their corners, of who they're going to put out there that they should probably go after, right?
And they will go after him, and they'll see how he does. You know, don't forget, I mean, he does have traits because he is long and athletic. I think, Adam, you may remember, I think when he came out of Virginia Tech, was he a fourth-round pick?
No, he was actually not drafted.
He was not drafted?
Nope, undrafted.
You know for sure?
Yep, I'm looking at it. He wasn't drafted.
Wow. Isn't he listed at like 6 feet, 6'1", though?
6'1". Well, the funny thing is, immediately, he did so. I just remember because I was at their training camp. I didn't know much about him, and I remember talking to their coaches there. Said, oh, yeah, he's been a story at camp. He's probably going to make a roster, and he did. But, again, he didn't fit what they're doing there with Brandon Staley. So, good story.
Interesting. Yeah,
they also, by the way, guys, I know you saw this and know this, but they also have Jesmond Trufant out there.
I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it because he was so bad for the Lions, you know, and he was also with another team earlier. Who was he with in training camp?
Detroit, wasn't he? Yeah. Oh,
yes,
you're talking about
– Yes, but he also went – after they cut him, he went somewhere else and he got cut.
Atlanta?
Well, that's where he started. I'll know about that.
Anyways.
I could not believe it. Did he look good, Greg?
Oh.
Desmond Trufant.
New Orleans was with the Saints. Saints cut him.
Yeah.
And Bears cut him too. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
How did he look?
How did he look, Greg? Because he got some snappage last week.
Yeah, I didn't notice him one way or the other, so that means he didn't look either good or bad.
Okay.
Let's put it this way, guys. I talked to someone who coached him and said he was the greatest guy in the world. He said he couldn't play anymore.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, I think if everything works out right with their players, he's not going to really get snaps because they're going to play with Haywood as the field corner, Faison as the boundary, and Hobbs in the slot. So I don't think Trufant's going to get snaps.
You like Hobbs this year? Like you've seen good things out of that kid?
Yeah, Hobbs is a good player, solid player.
Yeah, he's graded out well. I will say CJ Uzama, if they do have some problems against these corners, could be a factor. The Raiders have been bad against the tight end kind of all year long now. Greg, I'll give you the unenviable task of breaking down the Raider offense with Derek Carr. You know, Josh Jacobs, as we've mentioned, though, has looked really good the last couple of weeks, and you got to give that kid credit. You agree with that, Greg?
In this game against the Chargers that he looked smooth and fluid with one cut downhill burst and acceleration. His lateral agility was good. He worked well in confined space. You know, he's not a small guy, Josh Jacobs. So I thought he looked really good this week. And he looked good a couple of weeks ago, too, against – who was it? A couple of weeks ago, we had 130 yards, give or take. And I can't
remember. He's looked good the last, three games. Really good, in my opinion.
I find this offense really interesting to watch. I mean,
probably the Colts, Greg, or Denver.
I think it was Denver. He had about 120, 125 yards. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right, John. You know, Carr is clearly a quality NFL quarterback. That's not even in question. I would say that throughout games, though, he still shows a tendency to move when he doesn't need to. He throws a lot of balls off balance. Because he's got that whip-like compact delivery, and I'm sure he's been able to do that since he started throwing a ball at whatever age. But his pure arm talent can often compensate. But I think there's kind of an inconsistency to me to his game. Not in a way where you go, oh, my God, he's no good. But, you know, I just think there's a little bit of an inconsistency to his game.
And then the matchup here, it's not great. Bengals zone-based. Knows him pretty well. They played this year, of course, and he didn't have a lot of yards, but I believe he completed a very high percentage of his passes. But
he did not have a lot of yards.
I mean, the simplistic approach would be to look at Darren Waller because the Bengals have been suspect against tight ends all year.
I got a thought on that, John.
All right, what do you got?
What's your thought?
You know, they signed Trey Flowers probably 10 weeks ago or so.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a starting outside corner for the Seahawks. And obviously they didn't think he was good enough to be the guy.